Peter Semensky. I'm the chair of the MFA in Visual Studies program. Welcome tonight. Thanks for coming out in this beautiful Portland weather. So I hope that we can kind of toast to a warmer night here and have Ralph really send us off into the opening of the lecture series for this spring semester at PNCA. Part of what distinguishes the visiting artists that are coming in is one of the things that they're doing with us is doing studio visits and getting a chance to visit studios of students in the program. So that's also happening during Ralph's time with us. It's also really nice to be able to bring a Portland artist to the lecture series, and I'm really excited that Ralph is the first of the year. So I'm going to introduce Matt Carlisle to come up and introduce Ralph. Thanks for coming out tonight.
Houseguest Residency with Ariana Jacob, and awards from the International Sculpture Center and the Foundation for Contemporary Art. Ralph Pugay is represented by Upfor Gallery in Portland. His work will be included in Costumes, Reverence, and Forms, a two-part exhibition at the Center for Contemporary Art and Culture at PNCA and Vox Populi in Philadelphia. Please join me in welcoming Ralph Pugay.
About my work right now because it deals a lot with humor, and we are not living in humorous times, but I feel very good in sort of like embodying the identity of being an artist, because at this point I feel like it's very crucial for us to embody that, because we are in a position to sort of remix and sort of like reorient the ways in which culture is going, and also to kind of create new realities or imaginable realities. So I guess I'm starting out with this image. This is the first drawing that I made in graduate school. And at that time, I didn't really know what I was doing. I felt kind of like uncertain, but like looking at it now, there are like certain themes that I feel like I could point to, like slippages of meaning in terms of like connotative meaning, as far as thinking about the concept of a burning passion for children, and how that might be translated. But I guess it's like I'm like really interested in like those slippages of meaning in relation to like the way in which we navigate the environments that we exist in. In this case, like I'm also thinking about global warming, and like global warming being something that's uncontrollable, but also something that we have to kind of navigate and sort of work around is something that's like really interesting to me. It's like I'm interested in like the way that we process emotions outside or like in conjunction with all of these things that are happening outside of our bodies. But I guess I'll step back. So when I was in graduate school, everyone kind of told me that these drawings kind of suck. And you know, it kind of hurt my feelings, but at some point I was like, okay, I'm just gonna make like really like bad work. Like I'm just gonna allow myself to suck. And so like this was the first painting that I did in graduate school. And like I was like really interested in this idea that, you know, it's like I was exploring how to paint without representational sources. And so I would like try to compensate for that by putting like a person on the margins. And like I'm like really interested in like this idea of like pulling someone's like, you know, like forcing someone's to kind of like look at the margins and like sort of like end viewing the painting with their attention value sort of just kind of like existing right here in the corner. In terms of like sources too, like I would say that the things that was inspiring me at the time and continue to sort of like make me think about different things are kind of like on the margin. So when I think about this section over here and the tradition of like miniature narratives, like global miniature narratives, I often think about how do you participate in that coming from a specific culture in this particular time, and like how, like, and then I'm thinking about like ex votos as well, and how in this case painting is not necessarily just about aesthetic effect, it's about a ritualistic form. So it's like, for those of you guys that don't know, ex votos are commissioned paintings, both in Europe and Latin America, for people that feel like they have been saved from peril by God, and then they're brought to churches. So it's like I'm like really interested in this ritualistic component of these types of paintings, that they sort of like exist outside of like a pre-established system. And then over here, the things that were inspiring me too were like game shows and reality TV, and kind of thinking about the narratives that are embedded in those thing, in those tropes, and how they are able to sort of like manufacture continuous stories of the hero's journey, but then we are able to sort of like project our own realities onto these participants, and that they, like, so the situations that kind of like brought them there are out of reality and into like media format. And then there's also MMORPGs, which are online multiplayer games. And I was like really interested in, like in undergrad, I was making money off of this video game called The Sims Online. And that's how I was making my living, was by using a bot to generate money in the video game that I would then sell on eBay. And I would make about $60 a day from that. And I was like really interested in like the slippages and realities that were happening, because it's like as I was playing this game, I was forming real relationships with people that weren't necessarily like existing within like my spatial existence. And so like thinking about my work, like I often think about like how like myths sort of like collide with everyday reality. So, I come from the Philippines, where Catholicism is like basically part of the culture. It's like it's the dominant religion in the country, and so it's like it really informs like the signifiers that I kind of put into these paintings, like snakes and how they've been mythologized, and like the symbolic meaning the snakes kind of signify in like various cultures. But I'm also like really interested in that ambiguity that they kind of like project. I'm really interested in like this idea of like double meanings, like where, you know, obviously like, it, like and gestures and like how they can sort of like enact different ways of conveying something. So in this case, it's a half woman, half bat that obviously has like wings out, but you know, through the process, like she's also kind of like selling these wares that she's stolen. And like, I'm like really interested in like the imagination and like how the imagination, like the politics of the imagination or like the politics of daydreaming, and how if you're coming from a marginal or like a sort of kind of, how do I say this? If you're coming from like this marginal position and where you feel somewhat subjugated to certain hierarchies, then your imagination or like daydreaming is like a way to sort of like empower yourself and like claiming a sense of autonomy. And for me, that's like very important, what it is that I do. And I also think about, my work in terms of taxonomy and syntax, thinking about like categorizations and like how you kind of like how you might translate something that has components within like an umbrella that you can then move around to sort of like establish new forms of meaning. I put this up. These are paintings by a post-colonial painter in the Philippines named Fernando Marsolo. And I didn't know about him until much like until recently. But I'm very interested in the way that he's kind of like taken on this tradition of the male gaze, or like this orientalist type of gaze, and translated it in like a Filipino type of form. And like I'm like really interested in this like aspect of translation where it kind of simultaneously sustains and subverts like pre-established meanings. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Like, you know, so it's like in the process of translating, you're acknowledging the fact that something has power over you, but at the same time, you're kind of taking ownership of it as a way to sort of claim it as your own. And when I think about my work, I think of them as like part of the same narratives, basically. But you know, crossing over different axioms of space and time, I would say. This one's called Jim Witchcraft. At the time, I was like really interested in this idea of like metaphysics, or like existing in institutions where metaphysics wouldn't normally exist. This one's called Chicken Pox Orgy. So a lot of my work kind of deals with ideas of, well, I mean, coming from the Philippines and like coming from like a country with a very Catholic background, to me, I'm like really interested in allegories and like how allegories function. in terms of like the proverbial. In this case, like I see proverbs in a way where the story in my head kind of the story is basically that like these people coordinated an orgy, but they all got chicken pox, and at some point they kind of like went through this like weird discussion as to whether they were gonna do it or not. And then they just decided to do it anyway. And this sort of like the result of that. And I'm like really interested in like this idea of like, you know, translating human behavior in terms of like computer terms. So we can think about like processing speed, and we can think about like a space in a hard drive, and sometimes you have like so much materials in your hard drive, but you don't have enough processing speed. And so this is what that's about, like this idea that you're kind of like running up against time. And so you just have to decide on what it is that you need to do. This one's called Dog Stabbing Contest. I'm really interested in the ways that people come together. Like, I'm really interested in the concept of, like, misguided certainty in this case, I guess. Like, and, I had a grad student at PSU email me, and, like, I guess, like, that term of, like, that concept of misguided certainty, like, really struck something in him, and that, like, you know, misguided certainty is something that artists endure all the time. Like, misguided certainty is, like, present, and that you, like, oftentimes, as an artist, don't know what the hell you're doing, or you don't even know if you're gonna like move somebody, or you don't know if you're gonna have a successful career, or you don't know what anything means, basically. You're just like hypothesizing all the time. This one's called, I forgot what this is called. But I mean, okay, so this was done at Skowhegan, and at the time, like, you know, when I made it, so it's like everything for me is like very subconscious and sort of, I guess, intuitive in terms of creating these scenarios. But at the time, I didn't know what it was about. But my friend Walter, when I was exhibiting it over there, came up to me and he was on acid. And he said, "Ralph, I finally got what that painting is about." And he said, "Well, you know, those lizards are not in the desert, so they must be cold, so they're hanging on to that woman for warmth." And I was like, "Oh yeah, that totally makes sense, Walter, but why is she nude?" Like, like I'm interested in like this aesthetic of diversity too. Superimposing that on like we like so like superimposing like a pre-established notion of diversity and the way that Benetton adds with like sort of like use the concept of diversity and then superimposing that on like something biblical and kind of like recreating the narrative of like how Ten Commandments might have been found. So imagining new pasts, imagining new futures, thinking about I mean, we're almost already there, like, why not? You know? The way that we deal with so many things are through this, like, industrialized way of making things a little bit more efficient. And so it's like, you know, how do we, I guess this is a way of me entertaining more, like, concepts of death in relation to, like, industrial gestures or like movements. There's a monkey turning to a man in a suit to meet his family playing Jenga. But I guess in this case, I'm really interested in like this idea of evolution and like how we have like this understanding of like what evolution is, but I guess I kind of wonder like how that sort of pierces into our everyday realities and Maybe it doesn't, I don't know. This one's called Young Lovers. At the time I was like really interested in this idea of sort of trying to expand the way that we perceive identities. And in this case, I was thinking, well, neo-Nazis hate other races, but they must like dogs, right? And I know how problematic that is, thinking about that at this moment in time. But I still feel compelled to sort of like create a space for me to sort of like understand the abstract feelings that people feel, even though I'm not in their position. Because understanding what it is that I understand about hatred, it also comes from feelings of suffering and victimization. And I know that's problematic, but I think it also needs to be said, because it's about creating diversity of understanding and knowledge at this time that's really important. And being able to say what you need to say, I think that's really important in this time. This one's called Ana Mendieta Back from the Dead, in which I imagine Ana Mendieta coming back from the dead, but she, through cryogenics, but she ends up like trying to start her art career again, and she makes really bad work because she's just filled with hatred that nobody shows up. At some point, I was kind of like lacking materials in terms of like what to paint about, and so I was hanging out with my friend Steve, and I asked my friend Steve if he could make me a list of things that he would never ever do in his life, and one of them was to make love with a shark. And I, that image was just so gripping that I just decided that it was worthwhile to paint it. And then my friend Jason, who knew that I painted off of Steve's list, also wanted a painting based on his idea, and he really wanted a painting of a mermaid giving a lecture. And so, just with that phrase alone, I was trying to figure out, well, what would that look like? She probably needs a lot of water, because she's out of her element. This was painted in 2010, before marijuana was legalized, and at the time, everyone was talking about marijuana legalization in California, which didn't really happen, but at the time I was, until now, but at the time I was imagining my upbringing in California suburbs, and how, you know, if pot was legalized in the Bay Area, or in California, that there might be like a pot mall at some point where, you know, everything that you have in there could be for your entertainment while you're smoking weed. And so this painting for me was about like creating a list of all the things that one would want to do if they were smoking weed. And so there are rappers up on the rooftop. There's people in a hot tub, there's hookahs, there's like a ball pit. There's a woman on a buffet table dancing with a snake. There's a cat petting room, a yoga room. There's like this rock gym over here. So it's like, looking at it now, it's also about me trying to be aware of my own biases. So a lot of this stuff is about like, you know, for me, painting is really more about not so much trying to hold on to a viewer's attention value, but more about holding my own attention value. So if I have a painting where I've looked at it long enough, then that means that it leaves me with a sense of wonder and makes me kind of like question my own perception. And for me, like, painting is about that exercise of reflecting through practice. And a lot of these turn into game-like exercises. This one was like an exercise in trying to render different animals and have them transform into human beings. This one isn't like that, but I was like at the time really interested in this convention of students making work about homelessness, but not really knowing what their subject position is, and making my own, like, sort of asserting my own bias on them as well. I guess I was like really interested in creating an image where it kind of like problematizes the role of an artist a little bit, in terms of like what it is that they can and can't say, or like what it is that they feel compelled to say. This one is about this is just about like this concept of like wanting something and not really having the time to like sort of like reflect on why you want it, I guess. But it's like you just want to belong so much, and like you just want to be part of that ritual so much that you end up like going through the gestures of wanting that you end up not really reflecting on what it is that you're doing. Oh, that's where it doubles. I was telling Peter that there might be doubles. Speaking of gestures, like with this one, I was like really interested in yoga poses and how they sort of reflect different types of other gestures. In this case, maybe they want gifts. And this yoga is gifts while they're doing yoga. This one's called Sports and Medicine. I'm really interested in collective gestures where the affects are like, or just the emotions are like so similar to one another. And I guess for me, it's about reflecting on the things that we do have in common, despite like differences in circumstances, based on the established sort of roles that we sort of adapt as human beings. This one's called Dogs Barking at Weapons. I'm just like really interested in like the way that we humanize animals, and you know, it's like it seems like dogs are trained to do this. Kind of like imbuing morality onto things that wouldn't necessarily have the language to sort of like establish morality. I was walking through a cemetery, and at the time I saw a woman that was in front of someone's grave, and I don't know how, but it just seemed to make sense that I would imagine her having a Starbucks cup, and that she would bring a Starbucks cup to her lover's grave because they met at Starbucks. But I'm interested in these environments where maybe sincerity could exist, where we don't necessarily imbue those environments with those types of emotions, or like those types of, interior operations. And then there are times when it's just about over-literalizing things, about like over-literalizing the way that oppression feels, and sort of like just allowing the viewer to sort of like take on, like it's not about creating the attention value of like putting meaning together for the viewer. It's just about like making them sort of like digest it and allow them to deal with it, essentially. This was based off of a story of a friend who ended up going to jail for like exerting violence on somebody else outside of battles. But you know, what I found really curious about him was that he seemed very okay with the experience, and I asked him, like, why are you so happy about that experience? He said, well, you know, it allowed me time to practice Tai Chi, and because I was practicing Tai Chi, nobody wanted to mess with me. Like, they thought that I had, like, other capabilities. So. But now this is in the collection of somebody who was, I guess he was the director of, like, the Department of Defense when Bill Clinton was in office. His Wikipedia page was very terse. this is, maybe I'm not gonna talk about that one. Because it's just about, like, it's about leisure. Like, I'm really interested in gestures of leisure and, like, superimposing things that are unnatural about them. And maybe it's about people ignoring the actuality of the things that they're navigating. To sort of, like, get at this experience that they were kind of expecting from maybe a few days ago. That's just, like, really endearing. But I think this one's called Extra Lucky. I'm really interested in dogs. Like, dogs are, like, you know, we project so much humanity into them. But I kind of wonder sometimes if, you know, if the other way around, like, what if, you know, we learn things from dogs, and that there are certain things that it's not necessarily like having power over something. It's about, like, cross exchange, and that they exist here for a particular reason based on things that we might not know about yet. So it's like a lot of stuff for my paintings is about speculation. This one's called Cattle Rave. I painted this, the beach. I guess I'm, I don't know, I put this up because I tried to turn Cattle Rave into a reality. But, you know, the cattle ranchers were really into it until they realized that I was going to bring other people to watch the cattle rave. And they thought that that was problematic, and that it was at OSS, it was at Oregon State University, at their animal husbandry program. And I guess they thought that it would be problematic, and that they might get in trouble in terms of, like, animal rights or I guess they just didn't want any sort of, like, problems coming from the administration of the university, so they didn't want it to happen anymore. So, but I'm still, like, looking for a place to make this happen at night, where you bring people in by bus to a ranch, and you can just, like, watch cows from far away, but you don't really see the cows. You just see the exterior of their bodies, sort of outlined by these colors. And I mean, I guess it's like a new experiment in painting. It's like what I'm projecting into it, thinking about color. I'm interested in, like, these aesthetics of sincerity, that if you look like you're really feeling it, then you must be feeling it. And at the time, how do I put this? At the time, I think, like, I was, like, trying to find excuses for lying. Like, I was, like, thinking about the aesthetic forms of, like, aesthetic form of truth, and, like, how that might look. Like, if we can distinguish what looks true based on someone, like, you know, looking at someone saying true things, then through that distinguishment, then we, like, it must be replicable. And, like, that's what theater is, right? But in this case, it was like I was like really fixated on this idea that truth isn't necessarily fixed. It's like it's sort of it kind of has its own slippages.
This one's called Beavers with Fevers.
Like these like grand gestures where you go into this place for something that seems mundane, but it's like then I ask questions about, well, why is it that in our culture saving animals is something that's not part of our everyday existence? Like, why is this such a grand gesture? I guess it's like, you know, how do we reorient culture to a point where this becomes somewhat of a better reality for everybody involved, like all living things? I love the fact that these guys are bonding over the use of Old Spice. I don't really know what to say about this one either, but it's like I feel like a lot of these paintings are like a reflection of my own neuroses about like trying to figure out what's good and what's bad, and then trying to figure out, it's like, well, who determines that? And like, who do I listen to in terms of like how that is defined? And like, why do I listen to that system? And then allegories of like just voicing out, like having a voice, and how hard that is, how like that's like a constant struggle of like finding your voice, or like even recognizing that you have a voice. And in this case, it's about like, you know, dissent being like really difficult when you're in a group of people, and how maybe that struggle is sort of cultivated from a very young age. Like things that I don't understand being superimposed on top of things that I don't understand, like those things kind of hold my attention. And I guess, and looking at this now, like I never put this painting in my slides, but I'm like really interested in trying to reconfigure things in a way where things that maybe are unknowable to me could be superimposed on top of one another, and speculating that maybe that would give me a better understanding of something, but more often than not, it doesn't. But I think it sustains my sense of wondering. And so it keeps my attention, and it keeps on stimulating me. This was me trying to figure out how to put a butt on an ocean. And I feel like I didn't do a very good job. But I mean, it's like, you know, thinking about that, like thinking about like the things, like the performance anxiety of like trying to conceive of something. I think for me, like this is why I like this painting, even though like it feels like there's like a lack of success in terms of like actualizing the butt of the ocean. For me, it's just about like recognizing like the lack of like that you as a human being are like fraught with like insecurities, and you have a lot of gaps in terms of like, even though you can try to sort of encompass the totality of like everything that's knowable in the world. Like in terms of translation, I'm also interested in like mistranslation. Like I'm interested in this idea that these people are into pain, but in this case, they're like enduring the wrong type of pain. And then this painting, for me, it's like I thought that this was sort of symbolic of like my own experience of my father, but it's not. It's just about this idea of how you have to hold yourself with a particular posture when you're navigating the outside world, and how complex it is to sort of like put the pieces back together once you go back to your safe space. Does that make sense? I was imagining that at some point outside of technology that we would realize superpowers in terms of mind control, but maybe in this world, the struggles of capitalist demand still pre-exists, and that now that we have telekinetic powers, we can still, but like, I don't know, like I guess I was thinking that even though we have telekinetic powers, that maybe the structures of oppression in the world that we're navigating would still be the same, and what that might look like. And then in terms of like technology being an extension of our bodies, I was entertaining this idea of what would our world be, or like what would our painting lives be? As a painter, like thinking about like, what are our new visions for painting? If we had infrared vision embedded into our physicality. I was working in an office job at the time that I painted this, and it was like for an interpreting company. And you know, before I went into my first day, I thought, oh, like it's gonna be great. There's gonna be like such a diverse group of people over there because it's a translation company. But it wasn't. It was just like a bunch of like, I mean, it was hipsters that were there, like white hipsters that were working over there, and like every person that was translating for them were just telecommuting. And so this is sort of me superimposing my idealism on top of like the actuality of the environment that I was working in. And then this one's kind of like a weird turn because like it's not necessarily like situational as much as the other ones, but I was like really at this time, which was like a couple of years ago, I was really interested in kind of delving back deeper into Filipino vernacular, like visual vernaculars. And in this case, I thought about the copre, which is like this animistic creature that smokes tobacco and like hangs out in trees and like hexes people. But I was thinking about that in relation to my everyday reality, and I was thinking about traffic in this case, and how those two ways of like thinking about toxicity could sort of like combine together, and like what that might look like. And then like this doesn't necessarily happen, like nobody fries with butterflies, but I'm really interested in like the signifiers that hark back to the things that I remember from growing up in the Philippines, and sort of combining them together to see what might happen. And this was from a dream. Like I had like a really strange dream, like a lucid dream. It felt like it lasted for 3 days inside of the dream, but it was like within one night, and it was after having had like an asiatsu massage, which is like someone stepping on your back and massaging you with their feet. And I was like really interested in sort of like creating one of the narratives from that dream, which was, the dream was really interesting because it was about going into a mansion which had the extension of like the Metropolitan Museum, but the Metropolitan Museum had different things, like they had a gym that used, like, you know, where you didn't necessarily have to do anything, like there were just power jets that would do the exercises for you. And then outside you would go, and there were people that were partying in top hats, but then there was like the thing that made the most impression on me was this hot tub that was lined with cocktail shrimp. And looking at this now, like I didn't even really need to paint the people. Like all I was interested in, like the hot tub with the cocktail shrimp. This was from like an actual experience of being up in Forest Park, or like seeing someone with like a baby, like a front face baby over, and like shooting an arrow. Like that just made such an impression on me.
is
like, oh, like you're doing both at the same time. Wow. And I was like thinking about, I mean, I guess in terms of like the technical stuff, and the technical sort of treatment for these works. So how I end up working is usually small to medium size, and I often think about like the physical motility that you have to embody in order to like make such small works. So it's like this gesture, right? And so it's like I often think about like what that gesture sort of like embodies in terms of like mind-body connection, in terms of semantics, and but also thinking about space, like, you know, I use a lot of isometric projection, and I feel like there is something really compelling about isometric projection that in the process of like creating a space where you see everything, the scale of the entities that sort of like exist in that space continue to be the same. So it's like in terms of hierarchies, like you have positioning, sure, but it's like I'm like really interested in this idea of like scale, in terms of how that might create hierarchies or like, you know, visually communicate those certain types of hierarchies. But then there's also, how are we doing on time? I think we're still good. Perfect. Okay. But then there's also sometimes I use approximate like linear perspective, and I'm like really interested in like, you know, linear perspective is like a Western convention, and thinking about that as like a design that is like created to like see the world in a particular type of way. And it's like in terms of translating, like I'm really interested in like the approximation as opposed to the actuality of those visual forms, because it just feels natural. It feels like it's within the realm of like what my work is about, or like what it is that I'm trying to express, which makes things easier for me because then I don't have to do math. I can just go for it. But you know, thinking about this painting too, like I often think about like hard edge like abstraction and thinking about modernism and how during that time there were like these various processes that people went through to figure out ways to solve the world's problems, in terms of like the world wars, and like creating concrete realities or creating empirical ideas of like how the world needs to be in order for it to be good. And you know, when I think about that, like it makes sense for me to sort of like superimpose these problems on top of those things. Because those are the things that I think about a lot. And then I think about like Rothko, like I think about Rothko a lot in terms of like the sublime nature of Rothko's. And I guess like Arnold Kemp also pointed out like Ad Reinhardt references down here at the bottom with the controllers. But I'm really interested in this idea that, you know, we kind of like create this umbrella for the sublime, but what would it be like to create or like imagine a world where there are multiple sublimes, different ways of conceiving the sublime. But then it's like within this like sci-fi corny type of environment, like really like there's something like somewhat endearing and sentimental about it. I'm interested in that balance between trying to sort of like transgress reality, but then how you negotiate that transgression with feelings of fear and like feelings of wanting to hold back. And reflecting on that a little bit is like a complex set of entanglements. This was also made at Skowhegan, and it was drawn from reality. Like students were just throwing popcorn at spider webs, and the spiders were eating it. And at that point, it's like it was made during the same time that I made this painting, and thinking about like the multiplicity of like different ways or like different vantage points that one could employ in terms of like living someone's life is like something really interesting to me in terms of like translating it into the animal world.
Thank you.
This one's called Spiritual Microwave. I'm gonna go back to that one. I'm like really interested in how the things that we interact with sort of like affect us and like in terms of like environment too. And I'm gonna talk about that a little bit more in terms of like a different project. But I'm really interested in how we imbue objects with meaning and like how we relate to those objects. But I guess I often question how deep we go into investigating the things that we interact with. And everything else that we don't understand, we put under an umbrella of like unknowability. But thinking about this, it's like I'm thinking about the way in which things inform our bodies. And like, in this case, at the time I was reading about Wilhelm Reich, and reading about chi and reading about like repression in relation to neurosis and physical motility. And I was thinking that, like, I was at Cash and Carry at some point, I was shopping, and there was, like, somebody that was working there that was pushing the cart. And at the time, I was having, like, a really serious episode of, like, back pain. And I was thinking about how, you know, well, other people also have pain, but it's like, in this case, it was like entertaining this idea of just chi being released from someone's body, but all towards that person doing the same thing that they were supposed to do in the first place. And then, you know, ideas also kind of like make sculptural interpretations, I suppose, where in this case it was like a collaboration with my friend Michelle Ricardo, and we just kind of like thought about Sisyphus, and for me it's like I was really interested in sort of like the back and forth that sort of happens with that story, and like the gesture of back and forth, and like how that, you know, like that gesture doesn't necessarily just exist within one's physicality, but it also exists in the mind, ambivalence. Like, I feel like this work was so much about ambivalence for me, in terms of like trying to figure out what it was that I was doing after graduate school. And like, I'm really interested in like these gestures of urgency. Like, I almost see, I feel like I have a tendency towards seeing collective gestures as if it was like a dance, but like a very complex set of dance scores. This one's called Man Growing Machine, whereas like there's a machine that makes you taller. Actually, the original name for it was Asian Man Growing Machine. Like, I think I was like imagining like a world where there was a machine that would make me taller. I'm really drawn towards like images of catastrophe, but like, how do you kind of like hold yourself? Like, how do you hold that posture against that? Like, how, you know, it's like, how do you adapt the things that you've learned through your history as a human being? And like, how might that play when you're freaking out? This one's called Wake Up, Baby. There was something about that phrase that just kind of like stuck with me. But the way that I visualized it was that there would be like this line of people that just like in a rush to shake these babies so that they would wake up. And in terms of catastrophes, I was like really into these, I guess they were public performances where I would fake a stomachache. And so the game would be me going out into public, and then I would drop onto the ground, and then at some point I would like roll around back and forth, and then the idea was that I wouldn't stop rolling around on the ground until somebody says, "Are you okay?" And then at that point, that was the cue for me to say, I think I'm feeling better, thank you. And then I would just walk off. And I really love those, just because it felt like I was hitting this spot where, in a way, it became like research material in terms of like thinking about how people react in terms of like a public space and how they sort of like enact things within public spaces, and just trying to figure out how different the results might be. But for the most part, everyone was helpful. And then I just had to stop the performances because a lot of people were calling 911. And so I just kind of had to end it because it was just too much. And then I'm gonna play this video that was... Traumatic design, and what if we were to conceive of post-traumatic design, what might that look like if it was like based off of, if it was based on, like, let's say a disaster and somebody had to rebuild right away, but they didn't, like, you know, there's just not enough time to sort of like process the feelings that you're experiencing, and how might that look like as a project. And I made a proposal to the Seattle Art Fair to make a steam room out of rice cookers and garbage, but they didn't like it, I don't think, because one, steam's not very good for artwork, so it was denied. But I was able to conceive of it at Rocksbox last year with some participants, and so we made a steam room out of tarps that was laying around at Patrick Rock's house, who owned Rock's Box. And then back around, like at the time, the Jesse Williams speech from the BET Awards just came out. And that affected me really deeply in a way that, you know, it made me understand things better in ways that I never did before. Just kind of like putting myself in a position and like acknowledging my own position within, like, you know, a collective meta narrative or whatever. But I, like, it seemed really interesting to combine a recording of Jesse Williams' speech from the BET with this steam room because in order to recognize someone else's body or recognize someone else's identity, it feels like there is some requirement on your part to recognize your own position in the set of those complicated circumstances. And you know, it's like thinking about physical, like the body in relation to space and like navigating spaces has always been like a recurring thing in my work. Like in this case, in grad school, I was making my own reality TV stunts. But they were based off of exercises that my physical therapist assigned me to do to get rid of my chronic pain issue. And at the time, it felt like everything was just urgent. Like I was dealing with so many things at the same time that I tried to figure out a way to collapse all of those things together. So it's like entertainment, and then like my physical therapy exercises, and then also making paintings. So through the process of like enacting these physical exercises, there would be paintings that were created based on those gestures. And so this is me doing the cobra on top of a piece of paper with a lazy Susan underneath of it. And like every time that I would do the cobra, like I would grab a flag, and then I would, and then once I grab all the flags, then the exercise would end. And like whatever comes out of that is what comes out of that. I'm also really interested in the uncanny. It's like thinking about things that we expel in terms of like how we conceive reality. And like, I guess for me, I'm really interested in the idea that it's like the environment can also have emotions, or like the natural environment kind of like responds to our own perception. And that it's like it's not necessarily us just having perception, but everything around us might perceive things, and we just don't know how to empathize with those things. And so we just don't question things because we don't have an avenue in which to do research on it or to explore why that might be valuable. And then thinking about physicality some more in terms of going back to Wilhelm Reich, he invented this invention called the Cloudbuster. And it, you know, I think with the Cloudbuster, he was able to grow grass in Joshua Tree, which is arid. But I was thinking that if so, he invented the Cloudbuster as a way to suck out life energy from the atmosphere and sort of like deliver it out onto the surface of the earth. And his idea about that is that it rids people of suffering and neurosis. And so I was wondering, well, if life energy exists in the atmosphere and clouds are things that suck up water through the process of evaporation, then are there things inside of our bodies that are evaporating? And like, what does that mean? Like, what are the ways that we can mistranslate that and speculate on it? And I was thinking that maybe evolution kind of happens in that way, where it's like our energies from like various entities in the world might get sucked up, and through the process they kind of combine together and create new forms or new meanings. I was living in Richmond, Virginia at the time, and you know, Richmond, Virginia is really interesting in that it has really great statues of really bad people. But I think for me, like thinking about this painting, I was like really interested in this idea of like collapsing history and collapsing this idea that pop culture and like rap in particular had its evolution from a system of oppression. And how do you kind of collapse that history into like a singular image, I guess, is like what I was entertaining when I was looking at this. And I was thinking with this painting of things that we put in our bodies, and I guess for me it makes me imagine different ways of how things that are outside of ourselves might inform what's going on inside of ourselves, and like then what are the things that go outside of ourselves, in this case babies. I think I was striving to have a better diet at this time. Really interested in like these double, like this one's named Double Negatives, but I'm really interested in like thinking about the environment as a body too, and like in a way this becomes like a fable where, you know, cultural or like things that exist in popular culture or things that we all share kind of collide with things that we'd rather not deal with or rather not acknowledge. This one's called Scanner. I was thinking with this one that if your body held memories through your muscles, and that that your physicality is transformed in a way by your traumatic experiences, that maybe snakes or other animals might also kind of hold certain types of trauma in their bodies. And with this one, I was trying to imagine what would traumas that snakes endure look like. This one's called Baby Coffee Politely. It was a billboard that was made for the Portland Biennial. I was like really interested in this idea of like uncontrollable release and like juxtaposing that with a way of sort of like holding yourself together as a responsible person that exists in society. Like also now getting into like these environments that hark back to video games, but really interested in water parks because they sort of like they're very organic in nature, but then they're like super synthetic, and it feels almost as if like they're imitating something else, like they're like versions of a reality that we wish we would have, like that already exist outside of our own making. And the way that they curve and the way that they're very unpredictable in terms of like what it is that they do. But on like, you know, with this image, I was like really interested also in superimposing this feeling of like loneliness within that environment. How am I doing on time? Okay. So I'm just gonna skip through this. This is like, this was something that me and my collaborators made. We were called Fuck Mountain. But we tried to recreate like a severe turbulence inside of an airplane, but I'm just gonna cut to the last part of it. So we were, like for me, I was like really interested in that, and that it kind of, it felt like there was something about it that harked back to what it is that I would like to paint. But then we would do other things, like we would put free iPads in front of a window of a gallery, so that the people outside of the gallery might, you know, harass the people at the gallery for iPads. We did a hike to Hooters, like a 4-mile hike to Hooters from Summers Park to Jansen Beach. And it was like a first annual Veterans Day hike to Hooters, but it only happened once. Because Hooters apparently is really expensive. And then, I don't know if Chitra remembers this, but I ended up dressing up as Kiki Smith's tail for a costume ball. There's just something about that sculpture that it just sticks to me. But, you know, thinking about that, like, it's kind of informed my teaching practice, too. So now, every time I teach a sculptural type of class. We always do this event called Kiki Smith in the Parking Lot, where I make them recreate Kiki Smith figures, and then we have an exhibition out in the parking lot. And then we've done Kiki Smith out in the football field. And then, like, these are, you know, reductive drawings of some of my students. And there's something about the reductive process that's just, like, super uncontrollable. And so I feel like it's a good contrast to sort of, like, the awkwardness that I find when people sort of, like, go through the system of schooling. But, you know, that's also kind of, like, inform some, you know, those exercises inform my sculptural practice. This was a sculpture that I made for a PMOMA event at Pioneer Square, and then at some point it made sense to just kind of like send it out into the world and like have it live its own life. Interested in that complexity, whereas like this person's obviously nude, but he's like so cute. There's like how can you be afraid of like a dude man like sitting inside of the and for a while like I was, you know, it's like that I felt really weird about painting, and so it's like I just started making iPad drawings in bed. And these are some of them, but you know, I was really interested in seeing how they might go beyond that, and so I started animating them. And so some of these are going to be exhibited here in April. These are news reporters reporting on ayahuasca art. And then, at some point, Ariana, do you want to come up here? So Ariana and I collaborated, and I love working with Ariana, but we collaborated on this project for Houseguest Residency called Sad Park, which is the world's first park for a seasonal affective disorder. Do you want to say something about it?
I don't know what to say yet.
Well, I was inspired by thinking about the visibility of grow houses now that marijuana is legalized. And like, how would the components of those spaces kind of, how can we reorient them towards more public solutions or like things that we kind of like end up problematizing in society? And in this case, like living in Portland, Oregon and coming from the tropics, you know, the rain is just terrible. But I guess for us, like, I mean, like from my conversations with Ariana's like really interested in public conversations and like allowing emotions to sort of like exist as part of like our public realities. And so it made sense that Ariana and I would collaborate on this thing.
Yeah, Ralph came up with the idea that we would work together to make this indoor seasonal affective disorder park as a proposal for a Houseguest residency. And then it was really fun. We just met coffee house, and basically in a couple of days put together a proposal, and we were like, haha, this will never happen. They'll never let us do this.
Yeah.
And then they did.
Yeah. And so it's like, that's what the environment ended up looking like. We worked with several friends to sort of like make this happen, from like signage to plans to events, and we have various events, like we brought an inversion table in, we commissioned someone to work on a fountain, Morgan Ritter, and we had a public life coaching event, like a lecture on nutrition. Allie Hankins did an aerobics event, and then we had puppy play time at the end.
We were just thinking about different ways that public space could be used for dealing with people's internal feelings, like thinking about the civicness
interested in like these creating a project out of these transactional ready-mades essentially, and trying to figure out like what resources are available within the periphery, sort of like conceive of a space that functions in a completely different way, and just kind of like collapsing various things to create something that's kind of like speaks on its own.
I also think like Ralph has such a good way of thinking of what if ideas, you know, and then actually making them come true. And that was what part of what this was too, was like thinking about a possibility that was somewhat possible but also somewhat like hilarious as an idea, and then actually making it come true, which was really neat.
Yeah, and so now, you know, after having experienced that, Ariana and I have been talking about, well, what's the next plan? So somehow it seems to make sense to create a permanent space where a sad park could exist. But the thing with sad park is that it's like seasonally, it's about seasons. It's like it's season dependent. And so now it seems like the thing that would make sense is to create a tropical arboretum. But I'm very fixated on this idea that the tropical arboretum would be underneath a condo space. Like it would be inside of a condo building, because those buildings are infringing on a lot of public spaces. So in terms of like creating more public spaces, how do you parasitically sort of like create something that makes use of like that pre-existing structure that seems indestructible almost?
Yeah.
So it's like, how do you kind of move around despite feelings of nihilism or cynicism? So
being kept out of everything.
Yeah. So that's the lecture. Thank you, guys.
Humorous has been at all limiting to where it can go in terms of like private collectors or galleries, museums?
Yeah, it's limited a lot, but I mean, thankfully I teach, so I don't have to worry about it. It's important for me to allow the bad ideas to exist, because I feel like it extends the complexity of the work, actually. And so, you know, if I allow the bad work to sort of like come in, it usually creates a rhythm when you look at the work collectively. And I feel like all good work should, like on an experiential level, should be able to create that, where it's like they bring you down and then like they bring you right up, you know? So it's like, when I think about the paintings too, it's like I don't just think about like this singular image, I also think about like the experience of being in that space, because it's like, I obviously think about spaces, like I love thinking about organizing like spaces and trying to redesign them. But yeah, so I guess, does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Has the use of psychedelics ever influenced any of your work?
No.
No?
No, not at all. I mean, I think for me it's about, it's just about living life and like, you know, having conversations that are actually pretty radical and like just allowing yourself to be present and like allowing yourself to sort of like have a voice.
Being that these moments happen in your everyday life, do you write down when you see something or when you notice something, or is it just a mental note that you take with you and then interpret when you're in front of the camera?
Sometimes it's like the ideas don't really exist until I start painting. So sometimes I just move a brush around and then things sort of like manifest naturally, but then there are times when I see something or like I encounter something while I'm taking a walk, and then I then remember that, oh yeah, like that's something that hits the spot. Yeah. It's very intuitive, but it's also like utilitarian in a way that, you know, when I started painting seriously, I was also working in an art supply store, and so I just like collected hordes of paints, and then that just kind of like naturally went into the process. So yeah, but I mean, I do like this idea that through making something multi-layered and cute through color that brings viewers in a little bit more. Like that's like a device in which to bring somebody into the work. Yeah?
You mentioned that some of your work is digital. I'm curious, do you have a different experience with the piece you're working on if it's digital versus analog, i.e. do you seem to gravitate towards different subject matter or if it's in a different mood, or is that inconsequential?
No, I think there is something about painting where it's like you have like the baggage of capital P painting over your shoulders every time you're doing it. It's like I'm coming from like a completely different position in terms of that narrative. But I mean, living in the U.S. for this long amount of time and like having worked in academia for this long amount of time, like those things still peer through. And so I think for me, doing digital work and animation is actually like liberating, like it's like an entry point to sort of like expanding the way that I define painting. Yeah.
I remember when you were talking about the sewer painting, you were talking about like the implications of the physical gestures of like making primarily small paintings.
Yeah.
I just wish you talked a little bit more about that, just about, yeah, like the implications of the size and the gestures.
It's about acknowledging the fact that it's like you don't want to move that wide. Yeah. And for me, I feel like my work is about the continuous question of like why you don't want to move that wide. And like the politics that's embedded in that.
Thanks so much,
Rob. Oh, one more. Can we do one more?
Yeah.
Ian. Hi, Ian.
It seems like your work has to do a lot with like questions, and then you answering it in some sort of kind of way, like, I mean, like science fiction or magic or religion. I'm kind of curious, like the process of like answering. It's like, what are you looking for when you're like kind of? Is it like a resolution, or are you looking for humor?
I'm looking for entryways in which I acknowledge my own subject position in relation to these preconceived ideas, and then trying to figure out a way to take ownership of it. Can you repeat your question again? I feel like I didn't answer it that well.
No, that was well. I mean, like, I was curious kind of on your feelings of like, yeah, kind of like the resolution of, because it seems like you have this question. And
yeah.
Then, like, you answered in some sort of way.
Yeah.
I was kind of curious about, like, yeah, your feelings on kind of answering it, and also, like, the means of kind of how you, like, what you choose also.
I guess the resolution is, like, whether or not, like, that the paintings that come out of the pre-existing mistranslations and questions turn into new questions. Thank you, guys.
So much better. I'll be here too.